Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Welcome to Wednesday night Bible study. We're just so glad that you're here. Thank you so much for coming. Cooled off a little bit today. We were spoiled for several days, and then now it turned off cool, didn't it? Colder, yeah. We're glad to have everybody. Have just a few announcements that we need to make. Troy James is in the Greenview Hospital, room number 415. Steve McClellan, who is a friend of ours, he's was the treasurer for Taylor Christian Camp for the last 25 years. He's having some heart issues, and he's in the Bowling Green Medical Center in room 3A19. Miss Glenda Taylor, we received word today that she is ill, and she is in the LeConte Medical Center in ICU at Sevierville, Tennessee, and they've asked for prayers from us, and so let's remember Glenda and her daughters. They're trying to take care of her. So Miss Judy came home, I understand. Bide Shepherd just didn't get the favorable results that he was looking for this past trip, and so his cancer is spread, and so we need to remember him and Miss Carolyn. And then the baby, Connor Tate's doing well. We have good reports about him, and then sympathies extended to the family of Miss Wandaline and the passing of her sister, Eva Jean, in Orlando, Florida. Any other announcements that we need to make? Let's have a prayer real quick for those tonight. Heavenly Father, hear our prayer tonight. There are those we need to lift up to you, and we just pray that their health will be restored. And we pray for Troy and for Steve and Miss Glenda and Miss Judy and for Bige. We pray for comfort. We pray for peace of mind. We pray for Connor Tate, and he continues to grow. We ask that you be with Miss Wandaline in the passing of her sister. Help all of these, Father, to feel our love, and may we have words of encouragement for them, to let them know that we love them, and we are so grateful for the avenue of prayer that we can come and lift them up for you. So we're asking, Father, boldly tonight that you'll shower each one of these with your blessings. In the name of Christ, amen. The Magi boxes are due. We extended that for one more week. They are due this Sunday. I think there's a couple of more boxes out there that are free to pick up, but we're just about through with that project. This coming Tuesday, March the 14th, we're going to have a blood drive here. We're needing some volunteers to help with this. If you have some time to give us for this project, we would really appreciate that. Also, can you advance the next slide for me? March 17th and 18th, Aubrey Johnson is coming, and he's going to present lessons, parables, parenting by the parables. We want to make sure to invite all our family and friends, especially those that are with teaching children, working with them in any capacity, to come and to be a part of that. Can you advance the slides? Can you? Uh-huh. You won't do it? There you are. Spring is in the air, and you're invited to a garden party. And we're going to have this garden party on the 31st of March in the fellowship room at 12:30 here. Lunch will be provided. And I was teasing them, Miss Charlotte, about that today, because when you put lunch is provided, you'll probably have some men that'll want to sign up for that. But then when you tell them we're going to build a terrarium, they might back out of it. But men and women are invited to this, and I hope you'll come and to be a part of this garden party. We're just so excited about that and about the efforts that's been put into that. Also tonight, Nick Chandler will be our speaker. He's going to speak to us the next few weeks on parables from the book of Matthew. Any other announcements? If not, we'll join in with our singing.
Please stand. Today I'll be singing Sanctuary. Oh Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, teach your children to stop the fighting, start uniting all as one. Let's get together, loving forever, sanctuary for you.
Let's sing. I'm in the way, the bright and shining way. I'm in the glory land way. Telling the world that Jesus saves today. Yes, I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is nearer and the way groweth clearer, for I'm in the glory land way. List to the call, the gospel call today. Get in the glory land way. Wanderers, come home, oh, hasten to obey, for I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is nearer and the way groweth clearer, for I'm in the glory land way. Onward I go, rejoicing in His love. I'm in the glory land way. Soon I shall see Him in that home above. Oh, I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is nearer and the way groweth clearer, for I'm in the glory land way. Please be seated. Do you need it down?
Y'all notice I didn't bounce up here like Cade did, and if I bounce like that going down, somebody come help me up. In John chapter 8, the Lord describes Satan as a liar and the father of lies. So what lies does he tell us? What does he tell us? Well, he tells us that God didn't really do that much for you when he forgave you of your sins. You was a pretty good person. He'll tell you now that you're a good person. Don't let God get too, that God stuff get too close to you. Well, I want to read an essay that was written by Hill Roberts that describes our transformation when God washes our sins away. The boys standing in their foyer had been plucked off the street, almost Oliver style. He was completely disgusting. His stench was terrible. He had obviously never had a bath in all his 10 years. The boy vaguely remembered that an old lady had once washed off his face. He hadn't much cared for it. Now the face under his ragged cap was streaked black and gray from the grease, soot, and grime that covered him from head to toe. Only his two white eyes gave any relief to the filth on the child's face. Did I mention how bad he smelled? A mixture of fire smoke, sweat, body odor, years of cake food grime that had been wiped off his hands and mouth all over his clothes. A bit of skunk and rat essence, the manure and urine on his feet and splattered up his legs, not all of it from animals. Many of the stains on his clothes were from his own vomit and bowels due to the almost constant stomach problems that came with scrounging garbage cans for his daily bread. All in all, he was horrible. His behavior was not nice either. Foul-mouthed, rude, arrogant, precocious, lying. He was picking their pockets even as they looked over him now. He figured he might be able to get work here as a servant boy, maybe cleaning stables or sweeping the chimney or scrubbing floors. But it would be worth it if he could just get one decent meal out of them and maybe a piece of silverware. Anyway, that's why he had gotten himself caught. On the street, he heard some pretty unbelievable rumors about these folks. They just couldn't be true. Clearly, the first order of action was to clean him up before he could live in this fine house. The boy was taken upstairs to the bath. He had never seen such a place. Spotlessly clean tile, or clean tile floors, big soft stacks of towels, and a huge tub filled with hot steaming water and piles of soaps. Gracie the maid stripped him to the skin. His old clothes were taken out hurriedly and destroyed with just as much haste. He had never been without those clothes, and now he was quickly becoming embarrassed. Fear of this whole thing almost made him bolt for the door. Baths were the stuff made for ridicule where he come from. But Gracie plucked him up and dumped him in the tub before he knew what had happened. He swallowed about half the water before coming up for air. After his initial panic passed, he discovered a bath was pretty nice. The warm water caressed him, cleansed him, washed off years of filth. Gracie scrubbed him all over. She pushed him under to wash even his hair. Imagine that. The soap felt delightful and smelled even better, like the flowers in the market stalls. The bugs that crawled over his body were washed off. The itch of filth was soothed by the washcloth. The scabs of the cuts and scrapes were softened and cleansed. Then out of the now stained bathwater, he was whisked, patted dry in those big soft towels, and his wounds were treated with ointments, which immediately brought a relief he had never known before. He was clean. He didn't even resemble the pile of dirt that had walked into the bath. He smelled like the bath, not himself, but it wasn't over yet. They took him into the adjoining room, a bedroom, he supposed, though he had never slept in a bed. To the side, two large doors were opened to reveal more clothes than he had ever seen. Fine clothes, worn clothes, soft clothes, beautiful clothes. He realized he must be in the quarters of the first son of the servant of the house's master. And this huge room was just his closet. A servant boy could surely get in so much trouble if he even touched the cuff of the nightshirt that hung on the door. Just then, the son entered the room, walked over to the clothes, and in a flash, picked out one of the most beautiful sets of pants, shirt, waistcoat, overcoat, undergarment, shoes and socks the boy had ever seen. He had never worn a pair of socks. The son dressed the boy in his own finest clothes. He led the boy over to the mirror. What he saw was astounding. No longer did he look like the street urchin he was. He had taken on the look of a master's son. The boy had been transformed for a new life as a servant in this house. But he didn't have a clue what to do now. It appeared that dinner would be next. This was just too good to mess up. So the only thing he could think to do was to try and follow the older son and do just as he did. The boy wondered what this inheritance was that the son kept talking about as he followed him down the steps. No matter, the food smells wafting up the steps were out of this world. Maybe the rumors were right. Maybe this really could be a new life for him. Gracie opened the door to the dining room. What a feast! He could eat well here just from the crumbs under the master's table. And there was an empty place right beside the son's with his own name written right on it, just like the son's. Yeah, he thought, I could get used to this. The cups were a bit odd, though, all running over like that. Oh, well, welcome to the master's table. So, as we leave tonight, remember that we are light, that Jesus has filled us with his light, and he has transformed us to look like him, to walk like him, to be like him. And we can do that if we just put ourselves behind him and follow him. Will you bow with me and we'll have a closing prayer? Our Father, we thank you for the love that you showed us when you sent your son to the cross. We're thankful for the forgiveness of sin that we received because of his great sacrifice. Sometimes, Father, we need to be reminded of just what you did. Help us to remember, Father, and be forever grateful. Father, there are those that are among us, our number, that are dealing with difficult times. And we ask that you bless those people. We ask you to help us to open our hearts and reach out to them and help them in every what way we can. We ask that you forgive us if you have aught against any of us. Protect us from the evil one. And go with us as we depart this place. In Christ's name, amen. Before we go to class, I have a favor to ask of you. There's a special little boy that has a birthday today. Let's sing happy birthday to Benson, and then we'll go to class. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Benson. Happy birthday to you. Thank you. Y'all go to class.
Thank you. I figured it out this time. I got me a chair. feels a little funny standing up there all the whole time. But I'm excited to see everybody turned out. We get to study the parables, so that's always fun. There's so much that you can look at on the parables. So I know I'm very long-winded, so I'll do my best to not try to go down every rabbit hole, but there's a lot of fun with the parables. So tonight we're going to start with the parable of the sower, because when you look at it and its context, it is the parable of parables, right? I mean, you start with this because it's going to ask us the main important question that we have to ask ourselves before we even start listening to Jesus. In the parable of the sower, Jesus is asking us, are you going to listen? How do we listen? So he's asking us this big question. Are you going to listen? So you'll see there's a picture of Franklin Roosevelt. And Franklin Roosevelt was known for his larger-than-life personality, for his big smile. He always liked to talk to people. Well, the president would get bored at all the White House functions where everybody would come in and they would shake hands and have these big meals and whatnot. And so one night he decided to do an experiment to see if people were actually listening to him when they came up and shook his hand. So the long line of people came by. They would shake his hand, and he would say in the most polite and courteous voice, he would smile and say hello, and he would say, "Hello, I murdered my grandmother this morning." And people would smile, and they would say, "Oh, bless you in your work. How great you're doing." And he just kept on. Everyone would respond, "Oh, that's lovely. That's lovely." And then finally, one foreign diplomat was paying attention. And he shook the diplomat's hand. He said, "Hello, I murdered my grandmother this morning." And the diplomat kind of looked at him, and he leaned in close, and he said, "Well, I'm sure she had it coming anyway." But listening, right? How do we listen? That's going to be the very important thing when we look at this parable, is how well do we listen? Before we get into that, I want to just talk about what is a parable. We use it a lot. You hear it a lot in church. It's a very common word, but what exactly is it? Right? A parable is a very powerful teaching tool. It was common for rabbis to use a parable. You can find parables in the Old Testament with the Old Testament prophets telling parables. But a parable, in its basic sense, is it helps us wrap our minds around a difficult concept, right? Because it's easier to come to a conclusion when somebody tells you a story rather than somebody boring you with a bunch of facts, right? Does that make sense? So it's a good way to catch our attention and to help us explain something. So I wanted to give an example that was not like a biblical example of a parable, because we all use these today. You can just call it a story. Right, and so I thought no better place to look than the greatest show ever made, and that is the Andy Griffith Show. Hands down, doesn't get any better than that right there. So I have a clip for us to watch to kind of put this into action here. But to give you a backstory before we go into this clip, it's about 2.5 minutes long. Andy has told Opie how it's important to keep rules, to follow the rules, not to break them. But then there's also certain situations where you might have to break the rule for the greater good. And Obi doesn't understand this. He thinks, no, you don't need to break a rule if you say don't break it. So Andy's going to explain this to him.
Joe won't be needing now. He decided not to run away after all.
He did? How come?
Well, you see, son. I just wanted to tell you that your boy's been with me. Oh, he's fine as a daisy. Yes, sir. Yeah, well, we'll be bringing him home here in a little bit. Oh, you're welcome. Yes. You see, son?
You told. Well, you broke your word. Well, you promised you wouldn't tell, but you did.
Well,
you said never let a friend down. But that's just what you did. You let me down.
Whoa, wait a minute. I didn't let you down. Oh, you think that I gave you a set of rules and told you to follow them, and then I went and broke them.
You did break them.
Well, now, let me see. Suppose there was a little lake, and there was a sign on it saying no swimming allowed. Now, that's a law. A law is pretty much the same thing as a rule, ain't that right? Well, now, suppose it was a little boy, and he broke that law and went swimming anyway and started to drown. Now, suppose it was a fellow standing there watching. Now, should he obey the law and let that little boy drown, or should he break the law and save the little boy?
Well, you couldn't let him drown.
Well, of course not. And I couldn't let George's ma and pa worry themselves sick of wondering whatever happened to him. besides that, there was an awful lot of busy folks out spending a lot of time looking for him. So, well, that's kind of the same thing, ain't it?
Yeah, I guess so, Paul.
You see, son, rules are very important things, but sometimes they seem to get in the way when we're trying to help somebody. So what we do in a case like that, we don't exactly break them, we just bend them a little bit. You understand that, do you?
Yeah, Paul.
Oh, there we go. So Opie couldn't understand why it was okay to break a rule in one instance, but in another instance, you weren't supposed to. So Andy tells him that story, and he gets it, right? So in its basic sense, there's a parable. It helps us wrap our minds around a difficult concept. But when we look at the parables of Jesus, it's much, much deeper than that. They're not just feel-good stories that teach us not to lie or be a good little person and all these things. There's way more to this. You can't just skim the top of the water. You have to dive in and look at this. They are stories with intent that's meant to open our eyes to the message of God. Now, I use that stories of intent because when studying for this, I used a book called Stories with Intent, and it just seemed to fit so perfectly. Why not, right? But it's by a guy named Klein Snodgrass. You'll never forget the name. And this is what he has to say about the parables of Jesus. And I'm going to read it. He says, they are used by those who are trying to get God's people to stop, reconsider their ways, and change their behavior. Biblical parables reveal the kind of God that God is and how God acts, and they show what humanity is and what humanity should and may become. Parables are not merely informative. Like prophets before him, Jesus told parables to prompt thinking and stimulate response in relation to God. Parables usually engage listeners, create reflection, and promote action. They are pointed and clinching arguments for a too often slow-minded audience. They seek to goad people into the action that the gospel deserves and the kingdom demands. It's a very scholarly example of the definition. I'm not much of a scholar. So to put it a little bit more simple, the parables show us the character of God, his love, and his mercy. These parables show to us who God is and how he operates. They're about him, his kingdom, and the expectations he has for us. Now, one thing we have to be sure of when looking at the parables is that we have to make sure they're in the correct context and we put ourselves in that culture. Because if we don't, we end up ripping these teachings completely out of context and we make them mean something way other than what Jesus intended for them to mean. Is everybody with me so far? Are we listening? Yes. All right, good deal. So, circling back to our first point. How well do you listen? Are you a good listener? Are you a bad listener? Anybody remember the last thing you said to your spouse or anything this morning? Is there something you're all thinking of right now that you were supposed to pick up when you left here and you have no idea what it is? Right? How well do we listen? And there has been a classic representation of this communication breakdown in the words of Led Zeppelin there. And that is from the great Charlie Brown. Yeah. Charles Schulz gave us this perfect illustration of how somebody's talking, but you have no idea what they're saying because you're not listening. Does anybody remember what the adults sound like in Charlie Brown? There it is. Thank you. Thank you. So just to refresh our memories, I have another clip. I got this thing figured out tonight. Let's listen to this real fast.
Playing hangman.
Study?
Oh, yes, ma'am. You're absolutely right.
So we have the wah, 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 wah. And so it's a great illustration. It's like two different worlds, a kid world and an adult world, and the two will never meet. It's just wah, 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 wah. You never know what the adults are saying. It's great. So now what happens is that I want us to think about this. Now I want you to imagine. We all start to hear that wah, 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 wah. Right? We hear it in our homes. We hear it, you know, when we're talking with our friends. We hear it in jobs. But we also start to hear it in churches. Right? We come in. We sit down at the pew, somebody gets up and they start talking, but all we're hearing is wah, 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 because we're thinking, what do I got to do this week? What was I supposed to do yesterday? Boy, I am hungry today. And, you know, our minds are going over and over and over. And so the words of Christ, whether we're reading Scripture, if you're anything like me, your mind will wander while you're reading if you don't pay attention. You could read an entire chapter of something and think, what did I just read? Right? You're not listening. Even in our own brains, we're not listening, right? What we're reading to ourselves. So the life-giving words of Jesus start to become wah, 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 wah. We become desensitized to it. The gospel no longer holds the weight that it deserves in our mind. Very simple. It can very easily happen if we're not on guard to that. So we're going to jump into Matthew 13. Now, when you're studying a book of the Bible, it's never a good idea to just dive straight first into the middle of it. Well, that's what we're going to do tonight, okay? So if you want to go ahead and open up your Bibles to Matthew chapter 13. That's where we're going to pick up. Now, to give you just a brief recap of chapter 12, before this, Jesus has healed a man in the synagogue with a shriveled hand, and he has upset a lot of the Pharisees and the teachers because that's a big no. You don't do that. So he's made them mad. Now he's given some more teachings. They've asked him for a sign to prove all of these rumors about himself, and he's saying, no, I'm not giving you no sign today. And so this is where we pick up. But before we get there, I want to ask you one question. I want to see how well we have been listening. Because if you're familiar with the Gospel of Matthew so far, we have read what Jesus has been preaching about. We first read about it in chapter 4, if you want to kind of think back in your brains. Okay, yes. If we could summarize the center, the core of Jesus' teaching in one sentence, what will it be? Yeah, what is it? It could be, are we thinking, is it love? Is it, you know, do unto others? Those are all aspects, but what's the one thing? How well have we been listening so far reading the book of Matthew? So this is where we get to do the best part, just a good old-fashioned Bible study, go back through. If you want to look at Matthew 4, verse 17. It says, from that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, you know, turn around, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. When we look a little bit further, Matthew 4:23, says, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. In Matthew 5, verses 2 and 3, says, and he began to teach them. He said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And look at Matthew 9, verse 35. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. So I think we have our culprit so far, right? Jesus' main message is that the kingdom of heaven is here. This is what he's been preaching, and if we've missed this so far, we haven't been listening. We've heard wah, 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 wah. So what does it mean? What does it mean that the kingdom of heaven has come here? Now, I cannot give a lot of time to this because we could go down a rabbit hole like no other and totally get off the parables. But to just try to put it very simple, think of it like this, that through the works of Jesus and the movement that he began, God is taking back his world from evil. Jesus is saying the kingdom of heaven has come here. So look, think of it as kingdom of heaven is crashing into earth. And through the when Jesus is telling us how we are to live in this kingdom, we're going to take back this world, right? We're going to love our enemies. We're going to do unto others. We're going to go the second mile. That's what kingdom living is. And that's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, I'm here to teach you a new way of living, and we're going to take back this world from evil. Now, we can go way deeper into this, but right now, that's where we're going to stay. Everybody with me so far? Everybody's lost. Perfect. Okay. All right. So, Matthew chapter 13. We're reading verse 1. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Remember, he'd been teaching before him in the synagogue. So the same day, such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. This is a great way of making a little natural amphitheater. If you're familiar with water and being on a boat, your voice carries more over water. So Jesus makes himself a little natural amphitheater. Everybody's all around. But let's think about this crowd for a minute. Let's think about the people in the crowd. How have people been responding so far to Jesus? Starting in Matthew, how have we been hearing about him? Or how have people been responding? Well, people have been curious. And also, Jesus is not what they expected. Even John the Baptist has started saying, are you really the guy? I don't know. Some people love him. Some people is like, I've seen what this man has done. I'm on board. I believe his words. Other people are kind of indifferent. They're thinking, I've got my own thing going on, but this guy seems kind of interesting, so I might go check it out if he's, you know, at a venue near me, right? And then last, we have people that just absolutely hate him. Already in chapter 13, we're seeing that people are plotting to kill Jesus. They don't like him. And when you think about this crowd gathered up around him, that's the people in the crowd. There's people that love him, hate him. I don't know. Maybe I'll go check this guy out. And I'm not too sure. All these people are there. And so this, like, when we read this, and we have to kind of take a step back and look at this through a fresh pair of eyes, like a poor first century citizen. Because when we read this, you would think this is the moment that Jesus gets to lay it all out there and address all these allegations because he has this huge crowd and he can address it. It'd be like you being the new person at a job or at a church and there's all types of rumors going around about you or people are saying this about you or people are just curious as to who you are. So you get a chance to stand up and say, you know, hello, this is me, this is what I'm about, boom, boom, boom. So when we read this, you're thinking, okay, this is where Jesus is going to set them all straight and he's going to tell them. But this is what we read instead. This is great. All these people are standing there in anticipation, waiting to hear what he's going to say. Jesus is in the boat and he goes, you know, a farmer went out and sowed some seed and as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and birds came and ate that up. And some fell on rocky places where it didn't have much soil. It sprang up quickly, but soil was shallow. And when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they didn't have any root. And other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. But still, there was other seed, and it fell on good soil, and it produced a crop. It was 160 or 30 times what was sown. And then to paraphrase verse 9, he goes, hey, do you guys have ears? So do we all have ears? We should listen. And that's it. There's your story. And so if you're standing in the crowd, I mean, we look at this story and it's so simple to us because we have the gift of Scripture. We get to read Jesus' explanation, right? We get, because the disciples, they don't get it either, and they say, what is going on? Well, this was our moment. I heard a preacher one time say, this is a PR disaster. You ruined it, you know? Think of the Billy Madison scene. You blew it. And if you're the person standing on the outside, you didn't get to hear Jesus' explanation. You didn't have the Bible to read it. And so you're standing there thinking, did I just come all this way to hear an agriculture seminar? Like, I'm not even that crazy about farming. Like, what's he talking about? Seeds and birds and soil? Like, what's he talking about? And Jesus says there at the end, he goes, do you have ears? Do you have ears? And what he's telling us is what we've probably heard our teachers or our parents say to us before. Do you have a brain? Use it. Think. Think for yourself. Jesus is saying, I'm not just going to give you the answers. I want a seeker. I want somebody who's going to search. He's like, I'm not just going to put it all out there, right? But don't we all love a concise answer, right? I mean, how many has ever watched a movie instead of reading the book? We'll figure it out like this. Or read the Spark Notes book instead of just actually reading the book. I mean, we all want to be, it's all about speed, right? I mean, how many of you have checked the time maybe 3 times already because it's like, hey, you got this long to tell me everything I need to know about this parable, right? We like to be concise. And so did the disciples. They wanted that. They just say, hey, tell us like it is and let's do it. But Jesus says, no, there's more to it than this. He says, some people, they're not going to listen. Some people, when I speak, they're going to hear, wah, 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 because it doesn't matter to them. They think, I'm uninterested. This doesn't apply to me. But other people are going to hear these words, and they're going to say, wait a minute, maybe... Yeah, and then if that, yeah. And the things are going to start to click. And to this is what Jesus is saying. He's saying, think on these things. It'll come to you. So as we said before, does everybody get it? No. I can only imagine how confused people were that was in the crowd gathered around, because the disciples who have been with Jesus, they have no idea, because... as you'll see, we have the gift of Scripture. And we prefer that short answer. We don't want to think. So they go up to Jesus and they say, Jesus, why are you speaking in parables? You know, PR disaster. This is not how this is supposed to go. So if you look at verses 11 through 13, it says, he replied, because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Who's them? It's the crowd. Right, he's speaking to the crowd. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. But whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see, and though hearing, they do not hear or understand. It says, they see me, but they don't really see me. They hear me, but they don't really hear me. Because they choose not to. Right, he's saying, if your heart is hard, if you have no need, if you think, I have no need for saving, I have no need for Jesus or that guy or anything he has to say, then it's just going to sound like an agriculture seminar. The words of Jesus are going to sound like wah, 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 just on and on to you, just nothing but noise. But if your heart is open and you're receptive and you're willing to dive deep in, then the teachings are going to start to click. See, and this is where we realize that the parables, they have a dual purpose. And this can get kind of scary if you start reading all the scholarly takes. So I'm not going to go that route. But they have this dual purpose. Jesus is saying that if your heart's open, it's going to draw you to me. You're going to be curious. You're going to say, oh, what is this? Let me go a little deeper. Let me seek. But if your heart's closed, well, it's going to reinforce that hardness and keep us from understanding. See, think about this parable. If you hear about all these seeds and you think, this guy, he's just Well, that's dumb. He's just talking about planting seeds and everything. I could have figured that much out, Jesus. Why don't they just, you know, why don't you put me out there in that boat? I can tell you about planting seeds. And he's saying, okay, the kingdom's not going to make sense. But ultimately, this is the best part. Either way, the choice is ours. We can just say, you know what, the words of Jesus, nah, I'm good. Don't need them. Move on. But we can listen. Because remember, right, we all have ears, right? We can listen. And we can decide to go deeper. We can decide to understand. See, Jesus knew the people were not going to listen to him. It's not like Jesus got down here, started talking, and then like started saying prayers. God, they're not listening to me. I did not plan for this. What's going on? He didn't do that. He puts it out there, and he lets us decide. He doesn't force us to decide either. He doesn't force the situation. See, you either hear the parables and you nod and you affirm, you say, oh, okay, yeah, yeah. And you just keep on doing whatever it was you were doing. You just hear the teachings. Maybe you hear the gospel message on a Sunday morning. Yep, I need to do that. Yep. But then you go out on Sunday night and you're still just living the exact same way that you were before. Right? Or you can hear the parables. You're confronted with this message of the kingdom because the drastic scenarios, they catch your attention. Right? These are not normal circumstances for many of the parables. And you start thinking, well, maybe there's more to this. Maybe there is, what's going on here? And then you start to adjust your life to fit his teaching instead of trying to adjust Jesus' teaching to fit your life. You can think of it almost as a secular example that somebody may hear a song and they say, man, this song is deep. This song just speaks on so many levels. And then you may listen to it and think, this is noise. How does anybody listen to this? Think of it in that sense. That's the same way that people were treating parables of Jesus at that time and still today. What are we hearing? Are we listening? Or are we just hearing wah, 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 wah? So what kind of soil are we? Because how we listen, that is determining our soil. Right, that's what Jesus is getting at here. All right, so we're jumping down a few verses in Matthew 13. And we're going to get to Jesus' explanation. Jesus says, listen then to what the parable of the sower means. He says, when anybody hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, well, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. That is the seed sown along the path. Remember, the path is hard. It's what everybody walks on. It's not receptive to anything. But here's a fun little trivia thing for you. The word understand means something much deeper in this context because we think of the word understand in our English language, meaning you just don't know what it means. You can't grasp your mind around it. But in ancient Hebrew, there is no word for brain. It doesn't exist. That's why we read so much about the heart in ancient Hebrew. For someone to understand something means they understand it in their heart, meaning that they have an entire life change. They take that teaching and they apply it to their lives. Are you with me? Okay, thank you. Thank you for the head nods. I appreciate that part. Okay, so he's saying somebody hears the word, but they refuse it. They don't need it. They don't take that and apply it to their life. They just brush it off. Right? Now, if somebody has the very thoughts, if someone hears the very thing that'll save them, and then they refuse that, their heart is hard. And when we refuse the only thing that'll save us, then it opens us up to be the target for all sorts of evil attacks. Look, it says, the evil one comes and snatches away. Well, if we refuse the very thing that will save us, we open ourselves up to be the victim of numerous evil things in this evil world that will lead to our destruction. Okay, so who wants to be this soil? Anybody? Takers? Nobody wants to be this soil, right? But do we have ears? We should listen. So he goes on, excuse me, and he explains, he says, the seed falling on rocky ground, well, that refers to somebody who hears the word, and at once they receive it with joy. They hear it, and they say, this is awesome, I'm on board. But since they have no root, they only last a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. So are we going to choose to follow Christ's teachings when we're tempted? Are we going to be considered outcasts because we are public about our faith and we want to represent Jesus in a positive light? Or when confrontation comes or persecution comes, we just say, ah, that was a phase. I'm good. I'm out. Right? If we only choose to follow Jesus when it's easy, we have shallow soil. It won't last. If we are going to hear the teachings of Jesus and know exactly what he wants us, how he wants us to live our lives and represent him, and then we willfully say, you know what, I'm going to do this instead because this is what I like to do, and you know, God will forgive me maybe, but I'm going to live the way I want to live, and then I'll just, won't last, won't last. Then he says, the seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. So what's second priority in your lives? Is it the teachings of Jesus? Are we listening to Jesus' teaching and playing that in our minds? Or are we listening to the worries of the world in our minds, to the pressures of life in our minds? Because whatever crop you water, this is the crop that grows. You can't juggle anxiety and Jesus. And Jesus is telling us here, look, you can't have weeds and thorns in the same field as this seed, this teaching that I'm giving you. You've got to make you a weed pulling business and get to work. You've got to confront it. You've got to get rid of it. If you clear a garden or you plant a field, do you just take off, go in there, no matter what the ground looks like, and just start planting? No. I mean, not if you want to grow anything, right? You got to clear that away, and then you start planting. Jesus is saying, confront this stuff. Don't just sweep it under the rug or bury it. Just confront this stuff. Get rid of it, right? Are we listening? Are we listening? And then we get to the last part, but the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. Remember, understands. They grasp it with their heart. They apply it to their lives. They make that change. They understand it. And this is the one who produces a crop yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. And look, there's different ranges of what was sown or different ranges of what they yielded. 100, 60, 30. Don't worry so much about how much you're yielding. Just be focused on growing good fruit, right? Be good soil that produces fruit. So how do you know what sort of soil someone is? You can look at their lives. You can see what are they producing. Does patience follow this person? Does love surround this person? Right? What's their priorities? How do they treat people? And this leads us to the question of, well, what kind of soil am I? Am I a good soil? Have I been listening? Right? How are we going to listen? I mean, it's all up to us. We can be hard soil and say, Jesus' words, wah, 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 wah. We can be rocky soil and we can just pick out the few teachings that we like and we'll stick with those. But the ones we don't like, I'm not going to listen to those. No, I'm good. We can be the weeds and the thorns where I'm for this, but if something else comes along, then I'm just going to let the Jesus teaching stuff just take to the back burner. I'll circle back when I get done with this. Or we can listen and we can be the good soil. We can produce a crop. We can take what Jesus is teaching us, apply it to our lives, and make that change. All right, so how do you know what kind of soil you are? Paul gives us a very good checklist Very practical evaluation in Galatians 5. So we have to ask ourselves, what am I growing? Am I growing fruits of the Spirit? Joy, love, patience? Or am I growing what is opposite of the fruits of the Spirit, the acts of the flesh? Am I growing hatred, jealousy, selfish ambition? It's very practical. Do I have more love, more joy in my life today than I did a year ago? Right? Are we listening? So we ask ourselves this, what am I growing? How well have I been listening? Have I understood with my heart? Have I made that life application? Or have I started to hear nothing when I approach Scripture? But wah, 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 wah. Have I just tuned it all out and become dull to the very words that saves me? So now, we have this great hope. As I wrap us up tonight, I'm going to land the plane here. So thank you for listening and sticking with me this far. We do have this great hope that we serve a God who does not allow us, or I'm sorry, who does allow us to change the type of soil we are. You know how simple it is to change the soil? Listen. We have ears, right? Right? We all have ears, right? We have to listen. And that's how you can change your type of soil. I mean, with God's help, we can become good soil, because with God's help, we can do anything, right? But remember, the choice is ultimately ours. Are we going to listen? Because Jesus doesn't press it. Jesus says, hey, if you want to listen, that's great. That's what I want you to do. But if you don't want to listen, it's on you. If you don't, go on. Go do your own thing. So I say all this because this teaching, it confronts us, and it demands our attention. We start with the parable of the sower because it's the parable of parables. There's no sense in going into any of the other teachings or the other parables if we're not going to listen, right? If we're just going to sit here and hear, wah, 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 what's the point? What are we doing? What are we doing here right now if we're not going to listen and apply? Not just listen and say, well, that was cool, move on, live the way we want, but listen and apply. So as you think about this, as we go out this week, I want you to think about this. Do you have ears? Do we all have ears? Yay, nay? We should listen. We should listen. So I'll close this out with a word of prayer, if you'll pray with me, please. Lord, we thank you for being our God. We thank you for loving us, for forgiving us. We do thank you for teaching us. And Lord, help us to listen to you. Help us to clear our hearts and clear our minds and to focus on you, because you are what truly matters. Help us to be that good soil, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.